गुड मॉर्निंग चिल्ड्रेन।
मॉर्निंग मॉर्निंग
विच चैप्टर वी कंप्लीटेड प्रीवियस डे?
मॉर्फोलॉजी ऑफ फ्लावरिंग प्लांट्स।
मॉर्फोलॉजी ऑफ फ्लावरिंग प्लांट्स। आई थॉट यू माइट हैव फॉरगॉटन द नेम ऑफ द चैप्टर। सो एज आई टोल्ड यू, ओनली सिलेक्टेड टॉपिक्स वी नीड टू लर्न, सो दैट इज कवर्ड। सो चैप्टर फाइव, दैट वाज चैप्टर फाइव, नो चैप्टर फाइव इज कंप्लीटेड and chapter 6 is deleted again, anatomy of flowering plants. It was also a tough chapter with so much to learn to draw. You have to learn to draw many figures in that, but that chapter is also deleted this year. And the next chapter we need to learn is about structural organization in animals. So already in detail we learned about in plants. Now we are going to learn about the structural organization in animals. This is also a lengthy chapter, but it had been deleted and we have only the tissues, the animal tissues to learn. Okay, so we need to learn only about the animal tissues in this chapter. And this is a continuation of what you had learned in class 9. I don't know whether you are remembering what you have learned in class 9. In class 9, you had a chapter named tissues, where you learned about different plant tissues and animal tissues. So the same thing, a continuation of that, a little more details you're going to learn this year. So different animal tissues, that is what you need to learn from this chapter. So remaining topics have been deleted. Okay, so shall we start?
Yes, ma'am.
Do you remember what we covered in our previous class? I agree that you know the name of the chapter. Which family we completed? Which family we discussed?
Solanaceae.
Okay. So floral formula, all those hope you are remembering. Yes? You have started revision for your first exam, periodic test 2 or 1? Periodic test 2. Have you started revising or completed? Completed revising or yet to start? No answer. Have you started? Yes. Okay. So let us begin with our chapter. That is structural organization in animals. Structural organization in animals. That is the next the topic or next chapter we need to learn. Chapter 7, structural organization in animals. So already we have completed about the morphological features of flowering plants. So next we are going to learn about some basic structural organization in animals. Now you all know that All living organisms are made up of some building blocks. Every living organism, they're made up of some building blocks. What do you call those building blocks?
Cells.
So cell, you can say, or you can consider it as the structural and functional unit of all living organisms. And how can you classify organisms based on the cells, number of cells present? Evelyn, how do you classify animals on the basis of the number of cells found?
Unicellular and multicellular.
Unicellular means single cell. You can take the example of any unicellular organism. Say for example, amoeba. Amoeba is having only a single cell. But with that single cell, they manage to carry out all the activities carried out in a multicellular organism, whether it is respiration, excretion, digestion, all the activities will be carried out by that single cell. Whereas in multicellular organism, that is not possible, because in amoeba, as I said, being a single cell, everything can be exchanged. Whether it is gases or nutrients, everything can be exchanged across their body surface. But in multicellular organism, as you know, there are many cells and it is not easy to carry out all these functions by simple diffusion. So we need a better mechanism. And in multicellular organisms, so many cells are there. And what can you see in multicellular organism? These cells will be grouped to form yet another structure, a group of cells having similar structure and function. They form a common group. What do you call that group of cells?
Tissues.
Tissues. Similarly, a group of tissues with similar function form?
Organ.
Organ. A group of organs form an?
Organ system.
Organ system. So that is a hierarchy of levels of organization in multicellular organism. Cells, tissues, organs, organ systems which make up an organism. Okay. So here in this chapter, you are going to learn in detail about tissues. So to begin with, what is the definition for a tissue? A group of cells which are similar in structure and work together to carry out a common function. A group of cells which are similar in structure and work together to carry out a common function is known as a tissue. Okay? So there are different types of tissues both in plants and animals. And if you compare plant and animal tissues, there are some major differences. In plants, majority of the tissues are dead. Whereas in animals, majority of the tissues are living. And because of that reason, in plants, the maintenance cost or the energy that need to be spent for maintaining their cells or tissues will be less, because dead cells will require less maintenance. Whereas in animals, majority of the cells are living, and to maintain living cells, more energy need to be spent. And we also have learned about the four major types of animal tissues in class 9. So who can tell me the four major animal tissues? Vidur, can you tell me the four major animal tissues? Vidur? Vidur, where are you? You are here. Unmute first of all. It's a shame if you don't say.
No, I don't.
With which tissue your body is made up of? At least some of the tissues present in your body, you can say. How do you move? Now you are just making some movements in your body. How it is happening? Which tissue? Which tissue helps you to move? You're not moving? No tissues? Shame. Vidur. Rijas? Very good. If this is the level, which are the tissues present in your body? Animal tissues. Four major animal tissues. None of the tissues are working now, I think. One tissue is not at all working. Which tissue is there in your brain, Rijas? Do you have a tissue in your brain? That is also doubtful. Even I have a doubt now. Is there any tissue? No. It's blank, empty. Top floor is empty. Who will tell me? Michael?
Nervous tissue.
Louder.
Nervous tissue.
Nervous tissue. Which is the other tissue? Michael, can you add the other three?
Muscular tissue.
Good. Muscular tissue, nervous tissue.
I don't know.
Louder?
I don't know.
I thought a new tissue you discovered. Anna, and before I pass on to Anna, Michael, your body is covered by what? Which is the largest organ in your body?
Skin.
Skin. What type of tissue is that? Skin comes under which type of tissue? Who can help him?
Epithelial
tissue. So epithelial tissue, nervous tissue, then you said muscular tissue. One is remaining. Very important tissue is remaining. Anybody?
Connective tissue.
Connective.
Connective.
blood, bone, tendons, ligaments, areola tissue, adipose tissue, all come under connective tissue. How can you forget blood? And I was thinking that you will easily list out all these. You people disappointed me. So Rijaz is going to sum up. Which are the four tissues?
Nervous tissue.
Nervous tissue. Now it started working. This nervous tissue.
Muscular tissue.
Muscular tissue.
Connective tissue.
Epithelial tissue. And the same will be repeated by Vidur also. Vidur.
Nervous tissue.
Hmm?
Muscular tissue. Epithelial tissue. Connective tissue.
Very good. How do you move? With which tissues you move?
Muscular tissue.
Aided by, helped by?
Muscles.
Muscular tissues by what? Alone the muscles can move? It needs support. It is attached to which tissue? Anybody? To which tissue is our muscular tissue attached to bring about?
Connective tissue.
Which connective tissue? To be specific, which one? Bones. My God, children, you people are disappointing me like anything. Okay. So already we had a brief introduction about tissues. And let's see which are the different types of tissues. So already, as some of you have listed out, we have epithelial tissue, connective tissue, muscular tissue, the neural tissue. Neural tissue is same as nervous tissue. These are the four types of tissues found in the body of animals. Then we'll start with the first one, epithelial tissue. Epithelial tissue is similar to epidermis found in plants. Epidermis is the outermost layer in plants. Similarly, epithelial tissue is found in animals. And epithelial tissue has got a free surface which faces either a body fluid or the outer environment. And this is because epithelial tissue is covering your entire body. It is lining the internal cavities, covering the internal organs. So that is why it is said that it has got a free surface. It will be facing a body fluid. So when it is lining a body cavity, its free surface will be definitely facing the body fluid. And when it is covering your outer part of your body like skin, it will be facing the outer environment. Hope it is clear. So epithelial tissue, or these cells found in epithelial tissue, it's having a free surface. This free surface will be either facing body fluids or it will be facing the outer environment. The reason for that is it is covering and lining your body or body parts. It lines the internal organs or the body cavities, covers the outer part of your body. So definitely they'll be facing, the free surface of it will be facing either the outer environment or the body fluid. Then the third point, here the cells are very compactly arranged. Compactly arranged means very tightly packed. Why? Because it has to serve the function of protection. So if there are so much gap in between and if these are loosely packed, it cannot serve the purpose. Okay? It cannot serve the purpose if these are loosely packed. So these are very tightly packed with very little intercellular matrix, and intercellular spaces are also very less. Matrix is a substance found in between the cells. So when the gap in between is less, the matrix present also will be very negligible. Is that clear? Shall I proceed to the next one? Yes?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Now, epithelial tissues, you can broadly divide into two. Simple and compound. Simple epithelium and compound epithelium. As the name suggests, simple will be single layered. and compound, complex, they will be many layered. Okay, many layered and single layered. Once again, epithelial tissues you can broadly categorize into simple and compound. As the name suggests, simple epithelial tissue is made up of a single layer of cells, and compound consisting of many layers. Now, coming to simple epithelium consists of different types. A simple epithelium you can broadly divide into squamous, cuboidal, and columnar. Once again, squamous, cuboidal, columnar. Columnar, cuboidal, and squamous. These are the three types of simple epithelium. And these, as the name suggests, made up of a single layer of cells. And you can find them lining the body cavities, ducts, and even tubes. So different ducts like bile duct. Different ducts. What do you mean by duct? A passage which carries some body fluid from one part of the body to the other. So it will line the body cavity, ducts or tubes. Yes, next we are going to see the first one. So already we learned that simple epithelium can be broadly divided into simple and compound. Simple is single layered, compound is multi-layered. Okay, and then we checked out for simple epithelium. There we learned that there are three types: squamous, cuboidal, and columnar. And these are made up of single layer of cells, and they line the body cavities, tubes, and ducts. And then we learned about squamous epithelium. So once again, epithelial tissue is broadly classified into simple and compound. Simple is made up of a single layer of epithelial cells. So this we had already covered. Now next we need to start with squamous epithelium, the first type of simple epithelium, and it is made up of a thin layer of flattened cells. It's made up of thin layer of flattened cells with irregular boundaries. So once again, it consists of a single layer. As the name suggests, it is simple epithelium, so it will be made up of a single layer of cells, and these are flat cells having irregular boundaries. Boundaries are not, as you can see in the picture, it's not in any definite shape. They are having irregular boundaries. And where do you find them? In the walls of the blood vessels and in the air sacs of lungs. Can you tell me another name for the air sacs?
Bronchiole.
No. Bronchiole. Bronchiole will branch into smaller.
Alveoli, I guess.
Alveoli. It will end in some balloon-like or sac-like structures. You call them as alveolus, singular, alveoli, plural. So you can find squamous epithelium in the walls of the blood vessels and air sacs of the lungs. And what are the other characteristic features we learned? It's a thin layer made up of flat cells. And these cells are having irregular boundaries. Now functions, they form a diffusion boundary. Means it acts as a boundary, a medium through where the exchange of substances will take place. And blood vessels and air sacs, you know that these are the two parts through where the exchange of substances takes place, like blood vessels and air sacs. In alveoli, exchange of gases takes place, and through the blood vessels also different substances are being exchanged across the blood vessels. So they form a diffusion boundary. So is that clear? You want to see it once again? So I'll just show those points once again. Squamous epithelium, it consists of a thin layer of flat cells having irregular boundaries. And where do you find them? Two specific regions are, more places are there, but two examples are the walls of the blood vessels and air sacs of lungs. And function, they act as a diffusion boundary, which means that across this epithelium, exchange of diffusion takes place. Hope you know what is meant by diffusion. What is diffusion? Anybody, what is diffusion?
The transfer from more concentrated areas to less concentrated.
Okay, movement of substances from a region of higher concentration to a region of lower concentration. So next we are moving on to the second type of simple epithelium, that is cuboidal epithelium. As the name suggests, and as the from the figure you can understand that it is made up of cube shaped cells. So that is why it has got the name cuboid epithelium, because it consists of cube shaped cells, whereas squamous epithelium, it was flat cells. Here it is, it has got the appearance of a cube like cells. And where do you find them? In the ducts of glands and tubular parts of nephrons. So you have different glands in your body, and from the glands there are certain ducts which carry these secretions into its target organ. Okay, so it is, you can find them in the ducts of glands and also in the tubular parts of nephrons. Tubular, nephron means what? Where can you find nephron? Kidney. So the basic filtering units found in a kidney, you call it as a nephron. So you can find in the ducts of glands and also in the tubular parts of nephrons. Then function, it carries out secretion and absorption, whereas in simple squamous epithelium, we said they carry out diffusion. It acts as a diffusion boundary, but here they perform secretion and absorption. And one typical example for that is the epithelium found in PCT, proximal convoluted tubule of nephron. So each nephron, in 10th standard you have learned, each nephron, if you take, it is having different parts, proximal part, distal part, then there will be a U-shaped part which you call as Henle's loop. Okay, so the proximal convoluted tubule is the anterior part of this nephron, and the blood has to pass through the nephron, the entire nephron, or including all these proximal, distal convoluted tubule, Henle's tubule, etc. And when the blood is passing through the nephron, it gets filtered and formed. Do you remember the name of that filtrate form? Glomerular filtrate. A cup-shaped Bowman's capsule. Hope you're remembering. So when the blood is passing through the anterior cup-shaped part of the nephron, which you call as Bowman's capsule, it will form glomerular filtrate. And as the glomerular filtrate is passing through the proximal convoluted tubule, distal convoluted tubule, etc., it will help in reabsorbing substances from glomerular filtrate. See, the purpose of filtering of blood in the kidney is to form urine. But initially, when it is getting filtered, you call it as glomerular filtrate. The entire glomerular filtrate is not becoming kidney, or it is not being removed from your body as urine, because as this glomerular filtrate moves through the different parts of the nephron, many of the substances like glucose, sugar, then salts, excess water, everything will be reabsorbed back. Okay, so that why I told is all these are not mentioned, but you should know what is the role of this proximal convoluted tubule. It's a part of the nephron through where the glomerular filtrate passes and reabsorption of nutrients takes place. And the epithelium in proximal convoluted tubule, they are provided with microvilli. Villi, you're familiar with. Where have you learned about villi?
Small intestine.
Small intestine. What is the role of villi in small intestine?
Maximizing absorption.
Maximizing the area, surface area for absorption. And microvilli means microscopic, very minute villi. And here, what could be the function of these microvilli? Already I gave you the clue.
Absorption.
It will help in
increasing
the area of reabsorption. Very good, Nevin. Okay, so these microvilli are present, or the epithelial tissue, the cuboidal epithelial tissue in the proximal convoluted tubule of nephron, they are provided with microvilli. It will help in increasing the surface area for reabsorbing substances from the glomerular filtrate. Now moving on to the third type of simple epithelium, columnar. Column, you know, rows and columns. Columns will be tall, pillar-like. So columnar epithelium, as the name suggests, they are made up of tall and slender, pillar-like. Slender means not very broad, thin. Tall and slender pillar-like cells. Their nuclei are located at the base. The position of the nuclei is towards the base of the cells. Then their surfaces are also provided with microvilli. And where do you find it? You can find them in the lining of the stomach and also in the intestine. You can find them in the lining of the stomach and intestine. The functions include secretion and absorption. They carry out secretion and absorption. So once again, they carry out function secretion and are found in the stomach and intestine. So before we proceed to the modifications in these epithelium, quick recap of all what we covered. So we learned about the four types of animal tissues: epithelial tissue, connective tissue, muscular tissue, and nervous tissue. Then we learned that the epithelial tissue, the first type of tissue, has got a free surface which faces either a body fluid or the outside environment, because it covers and lines the body or the body parts. And here the cells are very compactly arranged with very little intercellular matrix. And you can classify epithelium into two types: simple and compound. Simple, single layered, and compound, multi-layered. Then we started with the simple epithelium, three types: squamous, cuboidal, columnar. It lines the body cavities, ducts, and tubes, and they are made up of single layer of cells. We already mentioned it. Then we started with the different types of simple epithelium. We started with the squamous one. They are consist of flat. They are having flat cells, irregular boundaries. It forms a thin layer. You can find them in the walls of blood vessels and the alveoli of the lungs, and they act as a diffusion boundary. Then we learned about cuboidal epithelium. It is made up of cube-like cells. They are found in the ducts of glands and also in the tubular parts of nephrons. And functions: they carry out secretion and absorption. And one typical example, the epithelium of which one? The epithelium of the proximal convoluted tubule. And this particular epithelium is provided with microvilli to increase the surface area of absorption. Then columnar, made up of tall and slender cells, nuclei located at the base. And here also the surface is provided with microvilli. You can find them in the stomach and intestine. They carry out secretion and absorption. Okay. Your turn. Let's quickly summarize what we learned today. We'll start with Sharon. Sharon, which are the two types of epithelial tissues?
Simple and multi.
Simple and multi, that's what I said. Simple, single layer. Then
multi, single layer, and multi, many layer.
Not multi, I gave some other name. What is that?
Compound.
Compound epithelium. So tell me about squamous epithelium. Sania, tell me about squamous epithelium.
Single layer of cells, and they are used for diffusions found in the
diffusion
air sacs and ducts of
guts. Characteristic features.
Found in air sacs of
The features, yeah. Characteristic features about the structural features I'm asking. Okay, a few points you told. Gayatri?
Ma'am, they are thin and flattened with irregular boundaries.
Then, irregular
boundaries.
Then the second type. Second type was cuboidal epithelium. Malavika, tell me about cuboidal epithelium.
They are cube-like.
Cube-like, then?
Their functions are secretion and absorption.
One place you can tell me where it is found?
Proximal convoluted tubule.
Of?
Kidney.
What do you call that? Base ring unit in the kidney?
Nephron.
Nephron. Okay, then the last one. Columnar epithelial cells. Punya?
They are long and elongated. The nuclei is present at the base. Secretion and absorption.
Means secretion and absorption. They carry out secretion and absorption. Okay, children, we'll wind up. We'll meet again at 1:40. Okay? So, Sania and Punya, you should be the first one to join the meeting. Okay? You have to carry on. Thank you, children.